lot of national forests are watersheds for communities for their water supply. And sedimentation and ash in their water supply can disrupt the equipment that they have to treat water. But the rains haven't come yet, and they will. When it rains hard and the water can't infiltrate in the soil, it's going to immediately start going downhill and pick up speed. And as it picks up speed, it's going to carry everything it encounters along with it. My name is Tom Giambra, and I'm here on the burned area emergency response team as a soil specialist. All the resource areas are here: wildlife, recreation, archaeology, geology, and roads. We're here to mitigate the effects of precipitation events after the fires. We want to know what's going to happen when the big rain events come. The first thing, and probably our most important task, is take satellite imagery, go out there and we validate it on the ground, in the forest, in the burned area. Confirm that if the satellite is telling us that this is a high severity burn, we want to see if it really is. The initial satellite imagery was showing a lot of high severity. Our analysis indicated that there's probably a lot less high severity than what the imagery showed. When you pass through an area that's probably showing up as high burn severity, you probably have lost all the canopy and all the vegetation on the ground. All the litter and duff is gone. Everything's burned off. Moderate, you probably still have some needles and leaves on the trees, and we kind of saw that as we came in too. And when you get into low, like we're in low right here, and there's a lot of green still up there. Some of the lower leaves and needles have burned off here or are brown, but some of these trees are going to survive because they got a nice green canopy left on top. The first thing we check for is soil hydrophobicity. So it's water repellency. It's often derived by compounds that occur in the vegetation, tannins and oils, things like that. So when they become part of the soil, that affects the water repellency of the soil. We use a water bottle. It's a simple water drop test. We put a drop of water and time how long it takes for that to sink into the soil. Sometimes it beads up really strongly, and we'll call that strong hydrophobicity. Sometimes it'll infiltrate immediately. That'd be no hydrophobic soils. Ideally, we want low hydrophobicity or none, because when it rains, we like to see the soil become saturated and not go down slope and not carry soil with it. We want to prevent sedimentation in the streams. We want to prevent debris flows, but we do our best, and sometimes we will actually implement treatments that can mitigate the erosion and stream sedimentation. For the wildlife people and the fish biologists, that is a value at risk.
Anytime there's a large wildfire, like the one that's happened here at the Smith River complex, the Forest Service will get together a burned area emergency response to do an assessment on what kind of damage occurred from the fire and is there anything that we can do about it. I'm Eric Merten. I'm a fish biologist here on the bear team. We're looking at, is there anything we can do to reduce effects from the fire on fish species? On average, fires benefit fish, and so that's unexpected to some folks. On average is the important thing. That doesn't mean you don't have the occasional events that are harmful. In this part of the country, just last year, the McKinney fire occurred, and in that case, there was a large sediment pulse that got into one of the rivers there and ended up killing a lot of fish. A number of things happen after fire when a fire burns an area. The most direct effects on fish are if a riparian area burns. Sometimes it doesn't. Like right here, we're in the middle of the Smith River complex fire right now, but this particular riparian area didn't burn at all. Wildfire can be good and bad for fish. Severe wildfire is more likely to kill fish and to have harmful effects, whereas a lighter burn is more likely to be beneficial to fish. But the fine sediments, the sand, the silt, the stuff that muddies up the water and fills in pools, that's a problem. It can clog the gills of fish so they literally can't breathe and suffocate. Depending on how much organic content there is in the sediment that's getting in, it also can, you know, take the oxygen out by increasing bacterial growth. In the longer term, it'll wreck the habitat. It'll fill in pools. It can cause a major problem for the habitat quality, and that can take a long time for that material to get flushed back out again and for the systems to recover. For most of the streams that are here, this fire is beneficial, but there's probably some areas where it might be more severe and where we might have, you know, excess sediment that's coming in and where it's causing a problem. this particular area didn't burn. But if we look at our burn severity map, 12 Mile Creek right up there burned hot. That was one of the hottest burning drainages in this whole fire. And so our soil scientists are going to look at 12 Mile Creek and that area around it to see what's going on with soil potential for movement. Our hydrologists will do some modeling as well, and we'll find out how likely is it that sediment is going to get from 12 Mile Creek into Patrick Creek. And from there, of course, it could move down into the Middle Fork Smith River. So we could have this whole chain of events that potentially can happen. We're making sure that we're doing everything we need to do to help minimize damage to ESA fish, as well as to promote their recovery.